Today we are going to discuss about a new topic called scalars and vectors, which comes under mechanics of first unit of BSc degree. I am S. Vidyarani, assistant professor of physics at MVS Government Degree College, Autonomous, Mehboob Nagar. First, let us see what is scalar. So under vectors, first we have to know what is a scalar. For example, here I have given an example of a car. Let us say length of the car is 4.5 meters. Here if you see, there are two parameters called length as well as 4.5 meters. So what does this word length means? So length means in physics, it is called as a physical quantity, or it is called as a physical attribute of some body. So this here length gives the physical quantity, whereas the value 4.5 meters or any other value gives the magnitude of that physical quantity. That means in physics, any physical quantity has a magnitude of some value. Here if you see the example, so the length is a physical quantity, whereas 4.5 meters is the magnitude of that physical quantity pertaining to this car. So length of a car is 4.5 meters. One more example, if you see here, I have given an example of gold biscuit. So if you see here, there is a gold bar here. So here if we there is a sentence given, mass of gold bar is 1 kg. Here if you see here, again there are two attributes, two values. One is physical quantity, one is magnitude of that physical quantity. Here that means mass is nothing but a physical quantity of the gold bar, which is here in the picture. Whereas this value or this unit gives the magnitude of this physical quantity. Here 1 kg is representing the magnitude of the physical quantity called mass of the given gold bar. That means every body has a physical quantity as well as some magnitude pertaining to its physical quantity. Here mass of gold bar is 1 kg. Next, one more example. Here I have taken an example of time. So time here it is given as 12.76 seconds. That means again here time is called as a physical quantity, whereas the value of time, that is 12.76 seconds, is the magnitude of at that particular point of time. So one more example, temperature of this thermometer is 36.8 degrees centigrade. Here again temperature resembles a physical quantity, whereas 36.8 degrees centigrade is the magnitude of the temperature. So now we will define the definition of scalar. So after seeing all the above four examples, we can define that a scalar is a physical quantity that has only magnitude. If you might have observed, whatever the previous examples I have shown you, in that there is a one physical quantity and pertaining to it there is some magnitude. That means it is called as a scalar quantity, because a scalar quantity can be defined as a physical quantity which has only magnitude. Examples, just now we have seen mass, length, time, temperature, volume and density. So these are a few examples pertaining to scalar quantity. Now we will move on to what is vector. Let us suppose we have shown a map from California to North Carolina. Okay, these are the two different states. So position of California from North Carolina is 3600 kilometers in west. So this is one example which can explain about vector. Here if you see, position of California, mind my words, position of California from North Carolina is 3600 kilometers in west. You might have observed I have highlighted three points in this are three parameters. One is position, one is 3600 kilometers, and the other one is, third one is west. That means, what is the difference between the previous examples? If you observe, you will come to know that here there is a physical quantity, same as in the above examples. And here is also one more other quantity which is similar to scalar quantity, that is magnitude. And the additional attribute that we are defining for a vector is the direction. This is the most important value for defining a vector. So in addition to physical quantity as well as magnitude, there is one more term related with the vectors, that is direction. So the only this direction, the attribute direction only differentiates whether a physical quantity is a scalar quantity or a vector quantity. So position is nothing but a physical quantity. So Carolina is, distance between these two states is 3600 kilometers, which is magnitude, whereas it is west to the North Carolina. Hence this shows the direction of the distance. So hence we can say that, one more example we will see, then we will define the vector. Okay. So one more example. See, I have drawn, shown the displacement from USA to China. Let us say displacement from USA to China is 11,600 kilometers, say in east. That means, again, if you might have observed, I have highlighted three terms, that is displacement, again, which is a physical quantity, 11,600 kilometers, which is the magnitude of the distance from USA to China, and here one more attribute or one more parameter here, that is the direction of the China from USA, that is, it is in east direction. So now we will define vector. A vector is a physical quantity that has both magnitude and a direction. Earlier case in scalar, only the vector, the scalar is a physical quantity which has only magnitude. But whereas a vector is a physical quantity that has both magnitude and a direction. Example, position. Few examples are position, let us say displacement, velocity, some more examples, acceleration, momentum, and force. So, how we will represent a vector? So, to represent a vector, I have shown a vector here, AB. So, A is called tail. The arrow direction is heading towards B. Hence, B is the head of A. Whereas, A is called as tail. So, A to B is nothing but magnitude of the vector. The magnitude of vector from point A to point B is nothing but AB. And the angle, we know that for a vector, we require two attributes. One is magnitude as well as direction. How we will see the direction? So, the direction pertaining to the axis of the A, or the direction of B with respect to A, is nothing but, it is given as direction. Here the direction is represented by theta. So that means, for representing a vector, we require a tail, we require a head, which gives the magnitude, as well as the point of head from the point of tail gives the direction, that is theta. Symbolically, this can be represented as, or the any vector can be represented as AB bar, or AB with an arrow on its head. So AB bar. There also can be represented by a single capital letter with an arrow above it. So here, if you see, few examples I have given. This is A bar, that means, which is a vector, that means it has both magnitude as well as direction. Here also one more vector B, which has both magnitude and direction. So here one more example P in the same manner. So representation of vectors, few vector quantities are represented by their respective symbols with an arrow above it. For example, normally in physics, For any position vector, we define with R bar. R is nothing but position vector. So hence, always position vector is represented as R bar. Whereas velocity vector is represented by V bar. And one more example, force vector is represented in the form of F bar, capital F bar. Types of vectors. On the basis of orientation, so these vectors can be divided into different types. So the first one is parallel vectors. So two vectors are said to be parallel vectors if they have same direction. If you see the first example, A, vector A and vector B are both are said to be both parallel vectors to one another because they are moving parallelly in the same direction. So we have to see the direction and decide whether they are parallel vectors or not. One more example, see if you see here P and Q, both are vectors moving in the same direction downwards. So we call them as parallel vectors. Next one, equal vectors. What are equal vectors? Two parallel vectors are said to be equal vectors if they have same magnitude. So in the before example, if you see, we have shown that they are parallel, but one vector is bigger than the other vector. Hence, we can say that they are not equal vectors. But if you see here, if two parallel vectors, that means both vectors should move in the same direction, as well as, and if their magnitude is same, that means the length of A or the length of the B or the magnitude of A and the magnitude of B are same and parallel in nature, then we say that those two vectors are called as equal vectors. So A bar is equal to B bar. One more example I have shown here. So P and Q are both moving in the same direction, hence parallel vectors, and both are having same magnitude, hence we can say that they are equal vectors. Finally we can say that any two parallel vectors having same magnitude are said to be equal vectors. So P bar is equal to Q bar. Anti-parallel vectors. Two vectors are said to be anti-parallel vectors if they are in opposite directions. Just now we have defined parallel vectors. In contrary to that, if the two vectors are moving in different direction or in opposite directions, then we say that those vectors are called as anti-parallel vectors. Here if you see the example, A, vector A is moving upwards whereas vector B is moving downwards. So hence they are in opposite in direction. We say that they are anti-parallel vectors. Same in the case of P and Q. Negative vectors. So two anti-parallel vectors are said to be negative vectors if they have same magnitude. That means if you see here, in case of anti-parallel vectors, so if you observe here the example of A vector A and B, so both are anti-parallel to one another. That means they are moving in quite opposite directions to one another but having same magnitude. Then we call it as those vectors are said to be negative vectors. So this can be represented in the form of A bar is equal to minus B bar. That means magnitude of A is equal to magnitude of B, but both are anti-parallel. To show the anti-parallel, we represent it with a negative sign. Hence we call it as a negative vectors. Here also if you see the example 2, so P and Q are moving in quite opposite directions but having same magnitude. So hence we call them as negative vectors, and in the same way we represent P bar is equal to minus Q bar. Collinear vectors. So collinear vectors are nothing but two vectors which are said to be collinear, then we call them as collinear vectors. In normal words, we can say that if both the vectors are acting along a same straight line or along a same line, then we call them as collinear vectors. So here if you see the example, vector A and vector B, are said to be collinear because they are both acting along the same line. When a line is drawn from point vector A to vector B, so they both are traveling or they both are acting on the same line, hence we call them as collinear vectors. Mind my words, I am saying that collinear vectors need not be in the same direction. See, if you see here, A and B are moving towards each other, or they are both moving in the opposite direction, whereas if you see here, P and Q are moving in the same direction. But acting along the same line is very much necessary to say them as collinear vectors. Co-initial vectors. So, if there are two or more vectors having same initial point, then we call it as co-initial vectors. That means all, if you take an example of two or three vectors, all those two or three vectors are having common tail. Okay, common tail. If all the vectors have common tail, then we call them as co-initial vector. That means they are starting from the same initial point. So two or more vectors are said to be co-initial vectors if they have common initial point. So here in the example, so A is having the same tail, B is having the same tail, C vector is also having the same tail, as well as D is also having or is starting from the same initial point. So all these four vectors are starting from a common initial point. Hence these vectors are called as co-initial vectors. Next, co-terminus vectors. What is co-terminus vectors? That means the vectors which are having common terminal point or common head. We can say that common head. So if two or more vectors are said to be co-terminus vectors if they have common terminal point. If you see the example here I have given, so in this picture vector A is having a common head which is sharing with the same point with B vector, as well as C vector, as well as D vector. So all these vectors are having same terminal point. Hence we call these vectors as co-terminus vectors. Coplanar vectors. So coplanar vectors are the vectors which lie in the same plane. So that means if all the vectors are lying in the same plane, are sharing the same plane, then we call them as coplanar vectors. That means if you see here, example, so this is a two dimensional, that means it's a plane. So in this plane, A, C, B, D are lying in the same plane. Hence, all these four vectors are called as coplanar vectors. Non-coplanar vectors. So if same as the above example, but little slight difference is that, so whatever the vectors are said to be non-coplanar means if they are distributed in space, that means if you see here, so B is in one plane, C is in one plane, A is in one plane. So all the three vectors are lying in different planes, that means they are distributed in space, then we call them as non-coplanar vectors. So we can also differentiate vectors on the basis of effect they cause. Okay, so first one is polar vectors. Vectors having straight line effect are called polar vectors. For example, displacement. So displacement happens in a straight line, hence we call them it as polar vectors. Velocity is also polar vector. Acceleration is also a polar vector. Force is also a polar vector. They happen in a straight line. The effect of these vectors is in a straight line. Hence, these vectors are called as polar vectors. One more type of vectors is that, based on the effect, is that axial vectors. Vectors having rotational effect are called as axial vectors. So whatever the vector effect is causing in the rotational change of the vectors, then those vectors are called as axial vectors. Examples of axial vectors are angular momentum, angular velocity, angular acceleration and torque. If you see all these examples, here the angular momentum, the effect of angular momentum is causing the rotational effect in that particular body. So this vector can be called as axial vector. Same is the case with all the other examples. Now we will move on to the vector addition of two vectors. How two vectors can be added? This is the geometrical method I am describing. First, one is triangle law. So I have highlighted here three countries: Egypt, Iran, and Yemen. Let us say Egypt to Yemen is defined by a vector A bar, whereas from Yemen to Iran I have shown with a vector B. So according to triangle law, the sum of two vectors A and B is nothing but the distance or the position of Egypt to Iran, or the points connecting from Egypt to Iran gives the sum of two vectors caused by Egypt to Yemen as well as Yemen to Iran. So here if you see, you better understand here. So here let us say here there is Egypt and here there is Yemen. So Egypt to Yemen is A bar, whereas Yemen to Iran is B bar. So now if I draw a line from Egypt to Iran, this gives my resultant vector of addition, that is, let us say C bar. C bar gives the vector position from Egypt to Iran. So C bar is equal to A bar plus B bar. This is how we show the triangle law in geometrical addition of vectors. Next, parallelogram law. So in a parallelogram law, here I have shown the arrangement of some pulleys and load. Okay, two pulleys are there which are carrying a common load. If I pull this rope, this load will move upwards towards the pulley A or the first pulley. Or if I pull B, the load moves towards the pulley, second pulley, upwards. So I am showing here upward direction with red line for the first one, with the blue line for the second pulley. So what happens? So that means when I pull or when I use force on the first pulley, this load is moving towards the first pulley in the upward direction. In the same way, when I put a force on this rope, and if I pull it, what happens? This load will move towards the pulley, second pulley, in the upward direction. So the same two lines I have taken in the second example here. So A bar is moving upwards, the direction is upwards. B bar is also moving upwards. If I imagine, or if I draw two imaginary lines connecting with the same lens, that is, imagine here also we have taken A bar, and here also in parallel to B bar again one more imaginary line drawn is B bar, then there will be a parallelogram formed here. So, and the points connecting from this point to end point gives the addition of vectors of A and B using parallelogram law. That is, C bar is equal to A bar plus B bar. Already we came to know that. So A bar is one vector, B bar is a second vector. If we add two vectors using triangle law, we get the vector from connecting from point A to point B in the direction of B. So hence, so using parallelogram law also, we can find out the addition of vectors. Next one is polygon law. So if there are five vectors, let us say, so four vectors, and totally after resultant vector we get fifth vector, we apply polygon law. So A bar, B bar, C bar, D bar, let us suppose there are four vectors A bar, B bar, C bar, D bar. And if we draw the polygon using these four vectors, so we get one new resultant vector called E bar in the direction of D bar. Because the vector is starting at A, ending, going through B, going through C, and ending at D. That means starting point is A, ending point is D. Hence, I have drawn a resultant vector E bar, which is starting point at A and ending point at D. Hence, the direction is towards D. So, E bar is equal to A bar plus B bar plus C bar plus D bar. This is how, using polygon law also, we can add few vectors. Now, we will observe the properties that are to be followed, or what are the properties that are followed by vectors. So let us see commutative property. As we all know, as we are mathematics students, we know that what is commutative property. So the same let us apply with vectors and check whether these vectors follow commutative property. For example, I have shown here there is a vector A bar and there is one more vector B bar. So there my resultant vector C bar E is nothing but C bar is equal to A bar plus B bar. Starting point is at A, right? And ending point is at B. Hence, for the new vector, my starting point should be at A and ending point or the direction should be at B. So that means we, from this first figure, we came to know that resultant vector C bar is equal to A bar plus B bar. Let us check with the other condition. Let us suppose, in contrary to this, the first figure, let us see the second figure. Let us say, now, vector is starting at B and moving towards A. Again, I have drawn a resultant vector C bar, and which is starting at B point and ending at A point. So, that means, again, C bar can be represented as A bar plus B bar. So, hence we can say that. So, in this case, if you see that C bar is equal to B bar plus A bar. So, from the first figure, we got C bar is equal to A bar plus B bar. And in the second figure, we got C bar is equal to B bar plus A bar, which is nothing but C bar is equal to A bar plus B bar as well as B bar plus A bar. So, therefore, in vectors, addition of vectors obey commutative law. That means the sum of two vectors in any order, A bar plus B bar or B bar plus A bar, gives rise the same resultant vector called C bar. Hence, we can say that vectors obey, vector addition obey commutative law. Associative property. So, one more property let us check for the vectors. Here I have shown in this example I have shown there is a vector A bar, one more vector B bar, so the third vector I am including, that is C bar. So A bar, B bar, C bar. So according to triangle law, if I add A bar and B bar, I should get this value, that is A bar plus B bar, which is shown with the imaginary line, okay, dotted line. So, this, let us say this is A bar plus B bar. Now, if I add A bar plus B bar with C bar, that means A bar plus B bar, C bar. My new vector, let us say, is A bar plus B bar, and the third vector which is having is C bar. So, if I add these two, A bar plus B bar and C bar, that means this value from here to here and as well as from here to here. If I add this, I should get it, according to triangle law, I should get a new vector which starts from A bar plus B bar and ends at D bar. Ends at C bar. So, my new vector I have drawn here with a black line starting from A bar plus B bar and ending with C bar. And I have named it as D bar. So, D bar can be written as A bar plus B bar plus C bar, In the braces, I have written A bar plus B bar. That means first I am adding A bar and B bar, which is my resultant vector, that is A bar plus B bar using triangular. Then I am adding this resultant vector with C bar. Again using triangular, I am finding out the D bar. So D bar is equal to A bar plus B bar in the braces plus C bar. And in the second figure, if you see here, again the same quadrilateral, we are explaining in a different way. Let us suppose there are three vectors, A bar, B bar and C bar. For a change, I am adding B and C vectors using triangle law. So if I add B and C using triangle law, I get a new vector called B bar plus C bar, which is starting at, which has a tail at B and which has a head at C. So this resultant vector gives me the, imaginary vector gives me the value of B bar plus C bar. Now what I am trying to do is, I am adding this B bar plus C bar with the first vector called A. So if I add both these vectors, that is A bar as well as B plus C bar, I will get a new vector again using triangle law, that is called as D bar. So here first I have added B bar plus C bar, resultant vector I am adding to A. Again, as it is starting from A and ending at B bar plus C bar, my resultant new vector will have its tail at A, whereas its head at D. So now this mathematical notation for this figure can be written as A bar plus, in the braces, B bar plus C bar, because I am adding B bar plus C bar for the first time, then I am adding the resultant value to the first vector called A. So in both the cases, if you observe, the value of D bar has not changed. That means both are have magnitude, having same magnitude and following the same direction. Hence we can say that D bar, or we can say that addition of vectors obey associative property. That is, D bar is equal to A bar plus B bar in the braces plus C bar is equal to A bar plus B bar plus C bar in the braces. Now moving on to subtraction of vectors. How will we subtract vector from a given vector? So the subtraction of B from vector A is defined as the addition of vector minus B to vector A. So if you see here, I have drawn two vectors A and B. Now I am adding, like suppose we have done in addition of vectors, that is A bar plus B bar. Same way, but here if you see, the little change in this is the direction. So here A is starting and B is moving towards this. So if you see here, A is moving here and B is moving in the opposite direction of previous B, that is minus B. It is parallel but in the opposite direction, hence minus B. So if you add these two vectors, we get A bar minus B bar. Now the vector A is remains the same, whereas the vector B, which is represented over here, is following the opposite direction to the previous one. Hence, it got a symbol minus. Now, if we add these two vectors, A bar minus B bar, we will get the value of subtraction of vectors. The subtraction of B from vector A is defined as the addition of vector minus B from vector A. In mathematical representation, it is given as A bar minus B bar is equal to A bar plus, in braces, minus B bar. That means we are adding vector A to the minus of vector B. Hence, we get the subtraction of vectors. Next, we have seen the vector addition in geometrical method. Now, we will move on to the vector addition through analytical method. So in analytical method, I have shown a parallelogram here. So O, if you see here, I have taken a simple figure. Observe this triangle, right angle triangle, OCM. So this triangle, if you observe, according to Pythagoras theorem, we know that OC square, hypotenuse square, is equal to adjacent square plus opposite square. So hence OC square is equal to OM square plus CM square. Next, OC square is equal to, from the figure, OM can be written as a sum of OA and AM. Hence, I have written, split it into OA plus AM. So, OA plus AM whole square plus CM whole square. Next, OC square is equal to, again expanding using the formula A plus B whole square. We know that A plus B whole square is equal to A square plus 2AB plus B square. So, using that formula, we are expanding this, imagining OA as A, AM as B. So, now we will get OA square plus 2 into OA into AM plus AM square plus CM square. Now, further simplifying, OC square is equal to OA square plus 2 OA into AM. Whereas here the sum of AM square plus CM square, that means sum of AM square plus CM square, applying the same Pythagoras theorem for the small triangle called CAM, we will get the value of AC square from AM square plus CM square. So hence in place of AM square and CM square, I have substituted with AC square. So in triangle CAM, we have to find out the value of theta. We know that cos theta is equal to AM by AC. So AM by AC, adjacent side by hypotenuse. Hence AM by AC, that is equal to, we will get the value of AM. That is, AM is equal to AC cos theta. Substituting the value of AM is equal to AC cos theta in the above equation, this equation changes in the following way. OC square is equal to OA square plus 2OA into, in place of AM, I have substituted AC cos theta plus AC square. So what is the value of OC? Let us see from the figure. OC is represented by a vector, resultant vector called R. Hence I have taken R square is equal to OA square. OA is represented by a vector P. Its magnitude is taken as P without bar, so P square plus 2 into OA. OA is nothing but again P, so 2 into P into AC. AC is the value of Q. That means here OB is opposite to AC. As it is a parallelogram, opposite sides are equal. Hence, this Q bar is same equal for the side AC also. Hence, we have taken the value of AC as Q. So, Q cos theta plus again AC square, that is Q square. So, taking out the square root of this value, we will get the value of resultant vector R. So, R is equal to on the root P square plus 2PQ cos theta plus Q square. So, we have found out the magnitude of the resultant vector of two vectors which are originating from the same point called O. Finding out the direction of the resultant vector. So, to find out the direction of the resultant vector, so we have taken the same parallelogram and we have drawn the imaginary lines, making a right angle triangle. So again in triangle CAM, sine theta is equal to, we know that CM by AC, that is opposite side by hypotenuse. So we get CM is equal to AC sine theta, whereas cos theta is equal to adjacent side by hypotenuse. So hence AM, we'll get the value of AM, that is equal to AC cos theta. So we have got the value of CM as well as we have got the value of AM. Now, applying this to the big figure, triangle OCM, which is a right angle triangle. So, we have to find out the value of alpha. So, tan alpha gives the value of opposite side by adjacent side, that is CM by OM. So, tan alpha is equal to CM by OM, can be split into two parts, that is OA and AM. Hence, CM by OA plus AM. Next, tan alpha is equal to CM is, can be defined as, from the small figure triangle CAM, we have defined CM as AC sin theta. Substituting the value of CM from here, so we will get it as AC sin theta by OA plus again we got the value of AM from the previous one, that is cos theta. AM is equal to AC cos theta. So I have substituted the value of AC cos theta. From this we can find out tan alpha is equal to, again AC is represented by the vector Q, Q sin theta by OA is represented by vector P. So again I have substituted the vectors in places of AC and OA respectively. So we get tan alpha is equal to Q sin theta by P plus Q cos theta. Now let us see the cases using the same magnitude and direction formulas that we have just now we have formulated. First case is, let us say if both the vectors are parallel. So I'll show the figure first. See here, I have taken these two vectors in different directions. Let us say if these two vectors, that is vector P and vector Q, are parallel, that means both are lying in the same plane or same line, then what happens? What will be the value of alpha? The value of alpha will be 0. So thinking the case that both the vectors are moving in the same direction, that means they are parallel to one another, that means there is no angle between them, that is theta is equal to 0 degrees, then how the value of magnitude changes? We know that just now we have formulated the value of the equation for magnitude. We know that R is equal to root over P square plus 2PQ cos theta plus Q square. Substitute the value of 0 because both are lying parallel to one another. There is no angle. Hence theta is equal to 0. If you substitute 0 in place of theta in this formula, so cos 0, we know that cos 0 value is 1. Hence we get R is equal to root over P square plus 2PQ plus Q square. So it is an formula of using a plus b whole square. Hence this p square plus 2pq plus q square can be written as p plus q whole square. So further simplifying, square and square root gets cancelled. We get the final value of r as p plus q when both vectors are parallel. That means when p and q are parallel to one another, the resultant magnitude of both these vectors will be p plus q. Direction. So same value we will apply for the finding out the direction also. So we have got the direction formula, tan alpha is equal to q sin theta by p plus q cos theta. Again substitute theta is equal to 0. So q sin 0 degrees by p plus q cos 0 degrees. We know that sin 0 is 0, whereas cos 0 is equal to 1. Hence tan alpha is equal to q sin 0 means q into 0, so this numerator becomes 0 by p plus q cos 0. Cos 0 is 1, so 1 into q is q, hence in denominator we will get p plus q. So 0 by something value is nothing, so hence again there is a 0 here. So tan alpha is equal to 0, that means alpha in tan is 0 only when alpha value is 0 degrees. Hence alpha is equal to 0 degrees, that means no direction. When theta is equal to 0, both the vectors are parallel to one another. As they are parallel to one another, there is no angle between those two vectors. Hence we got alpha is equal to 0 degrees. Next case, let us think these two vectors are perpendicular to one another. I'll show the previous figure, you'll better understand. So in this figure, again I am saying that second case, P and Q are perpendicular to one another. That means the angle made by these two vectors P and Q is 90 degrees. That means they are both perpendicular to one another. In that case, now we will find out the magnitude as well as direction of the values when both the vectors are perpendicular. That means theta is equal to 90 degrees. When theta is equal to 90 degrees, again substituting the value of theta as 90 degrees in the equation, in the formula of R, that is R is equal to P square plus 2PQ cos 90 degrees plus Q square. We know that cos 90 degrees is 0. Hence R is equal to P square plus Q square. So R is equal to under root finally we got it as on the root p square plus q square. So that means here I have shown in the figure vector p is lying in the horizontal direction, vector q is straightly perpendicular to p. That means angle made by p and q are 90 degrees. So this can be shown here. See, p and q are both perpendicular to one another. So the resultant vector is r bar here lying here, and the angle made by these two vectors is alpha. So now direction tan alpha is equal to q sine 90 degrees by p plus q cos 90 degrees. Same formula we are substituting. So we know that sine 90 is 1, hence we got q into 1 as q in numerator, whereas in denominator cos 90 is 0, hence p plus 0 gives rise to p. So we got tan alpha is equal to q by p, whereas alpha is equal to tan inverse q by p. Next case, if we consider vectors are antiparallel to one another. Antiparallel means both are moving in the opposite direction. Both are moving in the opposite direction means the angle should be 180 degrees. Hence, now what happens, both are moving in the opposite direction means there is a minus over here, which is showing that they are moving in the opposite direction. Now again, magnitude, if we see, again substituting the value of theta, that is as 180 degrees, we know that cos 180 is minus 1, hence we got it as minus 1 over here. So it can be further simplified as p minus q whole square. Hence square and square root gets cancelled. R gives rise to p minus q. Resultant vector is r is equal to p minus q. So if we say that when two vectors are moving anti-parallel, then the resultant vector is given by the values of p minus q vectors. Direction, if you see, tan alpha is equal to q sine 180 degrees by p plus q cos 180 degrees. Sine 180 degrees is 0, hence when there is a 0 in numerator, then we will get it as 0. So tan alpha value is 0, but alpha can be 0 degrees if p is greater than q. If p is less than q, then alpha might be even 180 degrees. For 180 degrees also, we get a value of 0. Hence, alpha is equal to 0 degrees means p is greater than q. If alpha is equal to 180 degrees, then that means p is less than q. Now, we will move on to unit vectors. What is unit vector? A unit vector is a vector that has a magnitude of exactly 1 and drawn in the direction of given vector. If suppose any vector is having a value of 1 or having a magnitude of 1 and drawn in the direction of that given vector, then we call that vector as unit vector. It lacks both dimension and unit. So as we have said, it has only magnitude of 1. That means it doesn't have any dimensions or unit. Its only purpose is to specify direction in space. So the purpose of using unit vectors is to specify a direction in space. So when we see a 3D, three-dimensional vectors, in that, to specify a direction of that particular vector, we use these unit vectors. So a given vector can be expressed as a product of its magnitude and a unit vector. Suppose any given vector, it can be expressed as a product of magnitude as well as a unit vector. Unit vector is always represented with a cap on its head. So for example, vector A may be represented as vector A representing a bar is equal to magnitude of A into A cap. A cap is nothing but unit vector. If you see the notation here, A is blue color, A is magnitude of A. Red color A represents unit vector along A. So hence, when we multiply this magnitude with this unit vector, we get the vector. So Cartesian unit vectors representing in a space. See, if you see here, so this is positive x-axis, this is negative x-axis. In the same way, positive y-axis, negative y-axis, positive z-axis as well as negative z-axis. To represent any vector towards positive x-axis, we show it with the I symbol. So in always for x-axis, For any vector, we use as I as unit vector. If it is in positive x direction, we show it as plus I. If it is in negative direction of x axis, then we show it as minus I. In the same way, similarly, for representing any vector in y direction, we represent with a unit vector called j cap. So j cap in positive y direction, minus j cap in negative y direction. In the same way, for z direction, we take a unit vector called k. If the vector is moving along positive z direction, we show it with a k cap. Whereas if it is moving along minus z or negative z axis, then we show it as minus k cap. So this is how Cartesian unit vectors are represented. Now we will find out the resolution of a vector. It is the process of splitting a vector into two or more vectors in such a way that their combined effect is same as that of the given effect vector. So here vector A is divided into two vectors called AT and AN in along the two directions. But when we combine these two vectors, again the same vector can be obtained. Rectangular components of 2D vectors. Rectangular components of 2D vectors are that, if you see here, along x-axis we have defined a vector called AX bar. Along y-axis we have defined a vector called AY bar. Let us suppose there is a vector called A bar from originating from point O, which is making an angle theta with x-axis. So now this AX bar represents the one component along x-axis. AY is called other component along y-axis, or the vertical component of A vector. The AX is called as horizontal component of vector A. So this is how we can represent using unit vectors. That is, it is as AX is along the direction of X. So we can show this as vector as AX I cap, which gives the vector of A in horizontal direction. Whereas AYJ gives the vector component of vector A in the vertical component direction. So the combination of these two, that means the addition of these two vectors, should give the resultant vector. So that means vector A is equal to sum of these two individual components, that is AXI cap plus AYJ cap. Again, rectangular components of 2D vectors is that, so again there is an angle theta. Here I have shown a vector is A. It is split into two vectors called AX and AY. So from this figure we can find out the value of sin theta. Sin theta is equal to AY by A, or else AY is equal to A sin theta. In the same way, cos theta is equal to AX by A. This implies AX can be the value of A cos theta. Magnitude and direction from components. So here A bar, I have earlier said that A bar is equal to AXI plus AYJ cap. So this can be shown in this figure, and magnitude is nothing but A is equal to sum of these two individual components, that is AX square plus AY square on the root. Direction can be written as, we know that theta is equal to tan inverse B by A, that is AY by AX. This is how we will represent the magnitude and direction using components, vertical component as well as horizontal component of a given vector. Next, rectangular component of 3D vectors. Let us see the example over here. First, let us say there is a vector called A. So this is split into, first this is split into A bar, imaginary line drawn here, plus AY bar. These are the two vector components I am taking, A bar and AY bar. Next, again this A bar can be split into two more components called AX bar as well as AZ bar. So hence, in place of A bar, I have taken AX bar and AZ bar. Finally, the vector A is split into three components called AX bar, AY bar as well as AZ bar in all the three directions. So hence this is called as rectangular components of 3D vectors. So it is this A vector A is defined in its components along all the three axes. Hence, A bar can be written as Ax magnitude, and I is the unit vector along x axis. Hence, A bar is equal to Ax I cap plus Ay j cap plus Az k cap. In this way, we can define a vector using components along the three axes. So, again, to find out the angle, again same formula is applied. Cos alpha is equal to, we know that Ax by A. So, Ax is equal to A cos alpha. Cos beta is equal to Ay by A. So, along x axis we take alpha, along y axis we take beta, and along z axis we take gamma as their respective angles. Hence, cos beta is equal to Ay by A, or else Ay is equal to A cos beta. Cos gamma is equal to Az by A, that means the angle made by Az with respect to A along z axis. Az is equal to A cos gamma. Next, magnitude and direction from components. So, we know that just now we have shown that vector A bar is equal to Axi plus Ayj plus Azk. And magnitude can be given as A is equal to square of all the three individual components along all the three axes. That is Ax square plus Ay square plus Az square. Whereas directions can be obtained as using the formula alpha is equal to cos inverse Ax by A along x axis. Beta is equal to cos inverse Ay by A along y axis. Whereas gamma is equal to cos inverse Az by A along z axis. Now we will add vectors using their components. So for example, here I have given one vector A bar which is divided into three components, Ax I bar A cap plus Ay j cap plus Az k cap. And one more vector B bar is defined as Bx I cap plus By j cap plus Bz k cap. Then we know the resultant vector. How to add resultant vector? R bar is equal to A bar plus B bar. Hence R bar is equal to Ax I cap plus Ay j cap plus Az k cap plus Bx I cap plus By j cap plus Bz k cap. So next, if we add all these three vectors, taking common of all the three unit vectors, so R bar gives rise to Ax plus Bx I cap plus Ay plus By j cap plus Az plus Bz k cap. So, in other words, this R bar can be written as Rx I cap plus Ry j cap in the y direction plus Rz k cap in the z direction. So, if you compare the left hand side values and the right hand side values of this equation, so we can say that the coefficient of I on the LHS should be equal to the coefficient of I on the RHS set side. So, hence Rx is equal to Ax plus Bx. In the same way, similarly, Ry is equal to Ay plus By. Rz is equal to Az plus Bz. So, what all we have learned today is that we have come to know how we can define a vector, what is a scalar, how we can show the geometrical addition of vectors, analytical addition of vectors, and what are different types of vectors due to their effect maybe or due to their geometrical way, as well as how a vector can be defined using its components, and how the vectors can be added using their components, and how the direction can be found out using their components of the vector. Thank you one and all. Signing off for today's class. Thank you.